You're listening to Write On by Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk to screenwriters about all the myths about screenwriting, like there's no such thing as overall deals. And we're going to disprove that myth today. We have a great guest on. Her name is Raamla Mohamed. You've seen her work on Scandal, Still Star-Crossed, and she's writing on a lot of other things, like a new show on Hulu called Little Fires Everywhere. And she's also writing and co-writing a pilot right now for HBO with Issa Rae. So, Raamla Mohamed, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Pete, for having me.
So, let's start off with how you got into, I think, storytelling in general. I know you went to film school, so let's start even before that.
So, I guess I always loved telling stories as a kid, which I'm sure every writer has a similar story in that way. I do remember when I was in college, I had these roommates, and I would tell them this like nighttime story that was essentially like a soap opera. And at first it started off as a joke, and then they kind of wanted to hear what was going to happen every night for like 3 weeks. So I always, again, I don't think in my head, you know, I went to college in the early 2000s, and I don't think I had any idea of what a television writer does or what like a writer's room looks like. So I didn't in my head say, you know what would be awesome is to be a television writer. But I do think as someone who loved television and loved film, when I finally made the decision to go to grad school and do this, it all made sense. It was like, oh, right. Okay, all those hours of television I watched and movies that I could quote, you know, like it all came from a place.
Yeah, I was curious about the, I mean, Columbia, you went to Columbia, and you thought, not enough film program for me, I need more, and then went to USC after that.
Right.
What was that decision?
Yeah, I mean, what's interesting is that at Columbia, which was great, I did English and, like, film studies, so it was more about, you know, the theory of film and mise-en-scène and, you know, kind of this intellectual juxtaposition, that word was thrown around a lot. So I kind of felt like I was on the path of critical studies or being someone who would, you know, be in some documentary talking about the intersection of, you know, some film and the historical aspects and blah, blah. But then I was working in New York and I worked in theater and I was seeing plays and I kind of was just like, I think I want to like write, like, I think I want to be on the creative side of this. So then that's when I decided to go to USC for film school for writing, because I was trying to write on my own. And again, I don't think it's necessary to go to film school, but I think you have to know yourself. And I needed the structure and someone to say, this is due this time for me to actually accomplish what I wanted to accomplish.
So after you left USC, at some point you started getting jobs in production. Can you talk about the beginning of that and how that came about?
Yeah, so I kind of did some odd jobs. I did like this Harry Connick Jr. TV special in New York when I was still working there as a PA. I worked on a couple of reality show sets, you know, just like, oh, I've, you know, work a week here. I'd babysit, I'd assist, you know, kind of odd jobs until a year after grad school. And I interned at Fox Searchlight when I was in grad school. But a year after grad school, I got a job as a writer's PA on Grey's Anatomy season 6. And that was the beginning, obviously, of kind of like my foray into Shondaland and what started basically my entire career.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that. You've kind of worked your way up through Shondaland.
Yeah. I mean, the great thing about Shondaland is that I'm not an anomaly. A lot of assistants have worked their way up, which I think is great because you hear of places where, you know, assistants don't get promoted and they're not seen as talent or writers. But, I mean, we had at one point, you know, the end of Scandal, where half the staff had been assistants in some capacity at Shondaland.
Wow.
And so it was just incredible. And, you know, you learn so much when you're an assistant at Shondaland. After a table read, you get to sit in and hear Shonda's notes, you know, so that, I mean, it was like a second grad school degree that I had, being able to be in that room, even as an assistant. So, and I also came in, you know, she was just starting to executive produce shows that she hadn't created. So the timing of it was also very nice for me.
Wow. I was going to say, obviously, they either do a really good job of forward-thinking hiring at the assistant level, or you're learning a lot on that job.
Yeah, no, you are learning a lot. I know that they do want people who have at least some kind of material so that they know you do want to be a writer and you're serious, because they want to promote people who are, you know, interested in doing this, which I think is great.
It is great. I mean, there's not a lot of, I'm not going to say there's not a lot of energy, but there's certainly not, that's not, like you said, it's not across the board. Not every show wants to promote. And most of them, I don't think, are taking the effort to find people that might turn out. They're not farming. They're not planning their assistance as a farm team.
Yes, exactly.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
It's hard to say that it hasn't worked at Shondaland. There's few examples of better success. So let's all take a note if we're running our own shows and producing our own stuff. Let's all take a note and make sure we do that with our assistants.
Yes, for sure. And I, you know, I was Jenna Band's assistant on Off the Map when it was a pilot and then became a show when I became the researcher. And I do feel like, I think people don't realize as the assistant, you know your boss so well, you sit in on calls, you know, you hear the complaints, you hear the praise, you hear the taste. So you actually, over time, really get to know the person and understand them in a way that sometimes even new writers might not know. You know, you can know like what this person might like or not like. So I also think that's the advantage of, you know, bringing in people and having them learn on the job and learn the show or learn the production company.
Right. Yeah. And then I guess you know it inside out.
Yeah.
Segueing into a question I really wanted to ask, I don't think we've really covered this much, but what's a researcher?
Oh, so a researcher, it actually was this great job I did not know existed. I covered the researcher at the time on Grey's Anatomy, I think season 6 or 7 was Meg Marinus, who's now a co-executive producer on the show. We're basically like, you know, on Grey's Anatomy, it was, you know, medical stories, and obviously they have, you know, a couple doctors in the room, but this person either might find a story that they find interesting, and then, you know, present it to the writers that could be, you know, for inspiration. So when I was on Off the Map, it was both a medical show and a cultural show. So I was learning about kind of, you know, infectious diseases, how they affect, you know, the Amazonian region. It's really fascinating because you're kind of just reading all day and then you're going, oh my gosh, and you're coming in and you get to pitch to the room, or someone does a story and you're reading the script and looking through it and saying, actually, you know, they're, you know, 12 eggs in a cart. I mean, no one does that, but you know what I mean? Like, you're just kind of like making sure that there's nothing going on TV that is, you know, not true. And if you don't have the expertise, you're coordinating with like outside experts to, you know, make sure that it's right. Like when I was a researcher, season 1 on Scandal, we did a plane crash episode. And so I found like 2 plane crashes that as examples that might get us kind of the story that we wanted. But then we brought in like an NTSB, you know, guy who also was a former pilot to like read through the script and be on set and make sure that things were going right. So that's the stuff that I coordinated as a researcher. It's a great position because you do get to be in the room, but you also, through research, get to understand story and like why a certain story might work or why it might not work.
What's an example of that? When do you find that it may work, may not? How do you know?
Well, I think you pitch it to the writers and then they tell you, I think, like the learning on the job, you start to understand, oh, if I pitch it, I should have pitched it this way, or this is actually the most interesting part of the story that I missed that someone else picked up on. So that's kind of what you're learning. And then you're able to read a story and at first you might be like, oh my gosh, that's interesting. And then you see and you're like, I think that might not work, you know, as time goes by. So.
Got it. And then I imagine that's just good practice in general for pitching in the room.
Yeah, exactly. Because I never, you know, I would be so nervous to even, you know, pitch the idea of what I read. But at the same time, I do think in some ways when I was a researcher, I was less stressed out than when I became a staff writer, because as a staff writer, I had to kind of pitch from my head versus, you know, reading something. So I kind of fell back a little bit into my researcher ways until I became a stronger pitcher in the room.
After that,
I didn't necessarily have to like read something to, you know, to like have an idea.
Right. So you don't have to rely on those pesky facts.
Yeah, exactly. You can just be like, oh, I just, in my imagination.
Right, right. So once you're on Scandal, I mean, there's a trajectory. We know, we've talked about this on this show before, but the different levels, you're a staff writer, you wound up being a supervising producer, right?
Yes.
So how does that ascension work? Because you did all that in one show.
Right. Well, I mean, the, you know, the Writers Guild is in the studio. If you're on a show every year, in your contract, you kind of agreed to certain title bumps, certain pay bumps. Obviously the advantage of being on a show for a long time is oftentimes if a show gets canceled or you leave a show and you go to a new show, a lot of times you may have to repeat that same level.
Sure.
I had a friend who had been on, she'd been on a staff writer for like 4 years because she'd been on four different shows that got canceled, you know, each one season. So they kept making her kind of repeat staff writer. It was a gift because the show was on the air for so long. So I was able to, one, you know, stay on the show and not be fired. and to, you know, be able to get those, you know, title bumps every season.
Yeah. All right. So one of the things we didn't talk about really was you were a Disney fellow.
I was, yeah.
And that's a competitive, that in and of itself is almost more competitive than just getting a job. So what was that like?
It's so funny because I applied for the program because when Scandal got picked up, you know, I was on Off the Map, but then Off the Map got canceled and Scandal got picked up and I was so excited about starting on this new show, but then heard it, you know, it was like we only got 7 episodes. And so that was in 2011, which now 7 episodes could mean another season. But at the time, it really felt like, oh, there's no way this show is coming back. Like, we're premiering in April for 7 episodes. Like, this is just kind of they're just being nice, I guess. You know, you just didn't know. So I applied. I was like, I need to have a plan B, or at least maybe a plan A. and so I applied for the Disney program. You know, I tell people that I wrote a Mad Men spec in essentially 3 weeks. Like, I broke it and outlined it and wrote it. And it had taken me like a year to write like some Dexter spec. Mm. And it's just, it's amazing what you can do on deadline. And I did it and I got through the first round, and then I had to submit another spec and a pilot and go through all the interviews. I mean, the good thing was that once I got to the final round, I did realize that at that point, it really doesn't matter. Like, everyone was pretty much on the top of their game and interesting in different ways. So I think there was some comfort for me that I was like, you know, it's just kind of subjective at this point. And there are some people who didn't make it, who were in my, like, in the finals that I met, that I'm still friends with and are doing awesome things, you know, which just proved that, like, it didn't mean any, it meant something, obviously, to me, but it doesn't mean, like, it's the BR end all if you don't get into the program.
Right.
But the actual program was a great experience because it was the first time I was getting paid to write. Which is the advantage of the Disney program because it's full time and you get salaried and benefits and all the things that you don't have to think about as an artist.
Right, right. You're not picking up those babysitting gigs.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I was like, I think I can maybe stop babysitting. No, I'm not sure.
So what were you doing? I mean, you said it's full time. What are you doing all day? Are you sitting in front of a typewriter and go, go, go?
No, actually, I mean, they have like, what's great is they had like speakers come in. Mm. We had mixers with people from the studio and network and from Disney, and, you know, former fellows came in to speak. We had like a fake writer's room to let you know how it was. Oh. And there's just various events through the week, and then part of the time you were working on your own spec. So you kind of had time to write during the day, but also there'd be different events. And we read each other's work and got feedback. So it was very, very involved.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, it sounds like there's a lot of work in that 1 year, you said.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, essentially after a few months, then you kind of go on a show. So I returned to Scandal for season two as a writer and Disney fellow. And again, we didn't really get our back nine pickup until we were shooting episode nine of season two. So it was a 13 episode order. So, I mean, I know why you're laughing because it sounds crazy because it ended up being a giant mega hit, but it was like years of not knowing what was going to happen.
So. Right, right. That's a great lesson in of itself, is that even at that level of mega hit, it's still years of not knowing what's going to happen.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So let's talk about this fantastic myth that we've been told over and over again, that overall deals don't happen anymore. We know that. Mm-hmm. That's fact. And you just got one.
Right. I did.
So what does it mean to have an overall deal? We talked about this a little bit on the show before, but landscape, now you're with ABC.
Yes.
What does that mean?
ABC Studios.
Yeah.
So an overall deal essentially means that you are you're employed by the studio, not the show. So it is, I guess in the scheme of security, it is probably the most secure situation you can have as a writer, to know like, oh, for 2 years I will be getting paid, and that this, you know, studio has put in, you know, their faith and money in me. Mm-hmm. And believe me. So you know, that is something that is an honor, but also, you know, I do know people still do get overall deals. I think you're right, it's not quite as common, but they do happen. I've noticed that in some ways. I mean, I can't speak for, I wasn't behind the scenes of what happened with ABC, but I do think that it's a very competitive market right now, and with Scandal ending, you know, and me being free to essentially do whatever, I do think that being in that position helped me a lot, because, you know, you obviously don't want to necessarily lose talent that you've kind of grown within your own studio to, you know, to then lose to, like, oh, now they're writing a hit show for Sony, or now they're, you know, for Fox, and what happened? They were here. So, so that was, I think, how that all happened. And so I was very happy that it happened. I have really good agents and a lawyer. So, they do all the things.
That's great. So you don't have to. You can focus on the creative stuff.
I can focus on the creative, and I can also, you know, I can also truly think about what I want, because there are also writers who don't necessarily want overall deals because they don't want to only have to, you know, work on one studio. They want to be able to jump from Hulu to NBC to, you know, Netflix, and jump around and not feel like, you know, beholden to one studio. So I get that. I mean, I just, you know, I was excited to be at ABC and, you know, create things for them. And then also this Hulu show I'm on is under ABC Studios too. And it allows me to work with Kerry Washington again. And you know, who's just amazing. So it all kind of worked out very well for me.
Yeah. So that's the writer's perspective on the overall deal. What's the studio essentially, what are they getting for their money? Why they're getting you, and what do they own?
They essentially, usually you are on a show and you are developing content for them. So that's essentially what they're paying for, are your ideas and your talent. And, you know, people think of writers as, oh, like you write all day and then you sleep and eat. But there's some of that. But there also is, you know, being a showrunner is a lot of work. It's making very quick decisions constantly, all day, sometimes all night. It depends on, you know, how, what season the show is in. It depends on how many issues you have. So I think that when, you know, at least I think that when a studio signs up for a deal with you, I think they are saying, we believe you can do all the things and essentially run a small multi-million dollar, you know, company.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of faith. It's a lot of pressure. But at the same time, you know, just with time comes experience. And there are a lot of things I look back on 6 years ago that I didn't think I could do that now I could do. So, you know, a lot of it is just patience and doing the work.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned showrunning. Is that what you're going to be doing on Little Fires Everywhere on Hulu?
No, I am not the showrunner. But let's say if, you know, the HBO pilot becomes a show, then I would be, you know, a showrunner on that. So, you know, I'm just trying to enjoy my non-showrunner duties right now until the time comes.
Yes, wise, I guess, wise move. When
yes, you know, Little Fires Everywhere, the showrunner is Liz Tegelaar, who's like an amazing, wonderful human being. So
sure.
We're having a lot of
fun. That's great. That's great. So what about the other, I guess I wanted to ask, there are other projects that you have, and is that normal to be able to write one thing while you have an overall deal somewhere else?
Well, the HBO thing happened first. Mm-hmm. So part of, I mean, overalls are rare, but, you know, part of what was kind of exciting is that, you know, I'm still like HBO is what they call carved out of my deal. So that, you know, they acknowledge that that happened. And, you know, if that were to become a thing, then I'd, you know, go to HBO and work on that. Mm-hmm. So, which is such an amazing thing that they offered to me.
Sure.
Yeah. So that's kind of, and it's not, I mean, that's something that some studios will do when they want someone who already has a project in motion, because, right, you know, they might not, they'll be like, well, we don't want to wait, you know?
Right. Well, they knew, I mean, you've obviously handled Bottled Lightning before,
before
it's on their brand.
Right.
So why lose you?
Yeah. I imagine that's what they were thinking, but it's always hard to know.
True. What about, we haven't really talked about process much at all here, but, how do you approach writing something new? I mean, let's talk about the pilot first. How does that work for you? How do you begin?
Well, I mean, luckily with the HBO pilot, you know, Issa and I were working together. She had the idea, came to me. She kind of had a little bit of the world and like some character stuff. So we started kind of fleshing things out more together. But I think in thinking about like pilots I've written on my own, I kind of think about something that like I really want to see, like what is the show I want to watch on television, and then go from there. And you know, for me, it's always like this: the setting is important, and the teaser is important. Like. Yeah. If I know how a show starts or some, like if there's some idea that I have and I can think about how it starts, then I kind of can start thinking about the show.
So that gets you that kind of nugget of idea, and then, and thinking is part of the process.
Yeah. Thinking is part of the process. You know, what kind of characters you want to see. You, for instance, you know, if you're someone, you're doing a hospital show, well, then you have to start thinking, okay, well, I need to see surgeons. I need to see nurses. I need to see patients. Mm. What, you know, like, so you have a template of the type of people you want to see, but then you have to decide whose story do you want to tell? You know, is this a show that every week is about a patient who comes in and sees this hospital through their eyes? Or is this a show about, you know, doctors, you know, like Grey's Anatomy, you know, like interns, you know, ER, is it a show about emergency and like, so again, they're all set in hospitals, but they're all different shows. So I think you kind of have to decide, what is my show going to be about, and who do I want to tell? Whose story do I want to tell? and then kind of go from there.
Right. Is that POV, the perspective?
Yes.
What the show's perspective is, essentially, then.
Yeah, exactly. So after that, you know, I really like to start with characters because I do think television is about characters. And, you know, you look at shows like This Is Us or Mad Men or Breaking Bad. And, you know, I mean, even like sitcoms, you know, like Friends and Living Single and, you know, Cosby Show, like people fell in love with the people. And the stories were interesting, but at the same time, you kind of would watch, like I could watch Whitley on Different World do anything, you know, because she was such a developed and interesting character. So that's why I try to start with character and then think about what scenarios can I create that would reveal character versus having the character serve a story I want to tell.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's revealing that first.
Right.
And then what do you do? Do you find sort of the most interesting journeys for that person to go on? What do you do from there?
I do. Yeah. It's a journey. It is. I mean, I always think it's interesting the decisions that people make when there's like put in a corner, you know. Right. I think that's what was really interesting about, you know, Breaking Bad and why people responded to it, because it was this guy who was put in a corner and just watching him slowly turn into someone else, you know, in a realistic way. That's, you know, that's really interesting. So I guess that's personally what kind of shows I find interesting, and that's the process I like to do. And then you start building the stories. You start what we call weaving them, where you're deciding where you want to put them, which order the scenes you want to put them in. For me, I kind of start in, like, either it sometimes can be like I email myself, or I start in a Word document and start doing beats, or like, you know, in the room we write on the board and or do cards. But for myself, that I start, you know, just in a simple document, and then, you know, then I'll get an open final draft, and I actually type the outline in final draft.
Yeah, we've heard that a lot of people, especially in TV, seem to work that way.
Yeah. So then there's something, what I realized for me was that what it did is when I actually start writing the script, it wouldn't feel like a blank page, like that blinking cursor. That's like my nightmare. Suddenly I was like, oh, there are words. I'm already at 15 pages, you know? And it's just more exciting. And then I could write, like I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna do these three scenes today or whatever. And then I could delete the paragraph of the outline and feel like the script was coming together. Mm-hmm. And then I could see if I needed to go back, like if I needed to go and look at, you know, later in an act and change something, it was right there. So I'm not like searching for all these documents.
Right. So it's always there, and I like that style.
Yeah, and also I'm like, in high school, I was kind of like a math nerd, and I do think there's something about like the puzzle, like it's almost like geometric logic that in some ways I follow, because it's like, I know how it starts, I know how it ends, now we have to do that whole proof, you know, like to get us there and connect these things. So that to me is the interesting part of, like, you know, earning certain story points.
How much detail goes in one of your outlines typically, how much detail do you believe in an outline?
It's pretty detailed. I mean, again, coming from television, it is a thing where a lot of times people's outline is so detailed that like anyone on staff could write it. Mm. So, you know, you have obviously the point of the scene, and then you'll throw in some dialogue, and the button on the scene. Like, I, in order to write a scene, I have to have those three things. I need to know how it starts. I need to have some kind of, I need to know the, so I need to know how it starts. I need to understand the turn of the scene, and I need to understand the button on the scene.
Okay.
And the turn of the scene, which some people don't understand, is what makes it a scene, which is like you leave the scene different from, like, the characters are a little different from where they started, or a new piece of information is revealed. I had a teacher at USC who would say that a scene is two truths changing each other. Hmm. Her name was Nina Foch. She was great. But so when you hear that, you're like, oh, okay. Like, I have to, there has to be something in the characters that at least change, whether it's knowledge or there's some kind of attitude or something. And there's always a point, you know, in a good scene or most scenes where that happens. But if I don't understand what that point is, then in my mind, I'm thinking this scene can go. Wow. It doesn't have a point. Mm-hmm. And as writers, we tend to overwrite. We're like, well, I need to explain how this happened and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, audiences are pretty sophisticated now. They're like, blah, 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 got it. Right. You know, so it's sometimes the over-explanation is what causes scenes that aren't really scenes. They're just setups. Mm-hmm. But I do think that trusting the audience can be very helpful.
I would certainly, that certainly sounds like a great note. What happens between the turn and the button? Because the turn is the, you know, the point that's in some way a climax to a scene. Is that?
Yeah. Yes. It is the climax of the scene. I mean, there's a great scene in Quiz Show, which is a Robert Redford movie. And John Turturro plays this guy who really wants Rob Morrow's character to, like, investigate that this quiz show has been cheating. And he's like, I know they've been cheating, because he's like this Columbia guy who's like, this white guy is winning and I'm losing and they're cheating. And Rob Morrow's, he's investigating, but he's not, like, he kind of thinks this guy's a little crazy, so he's not sure. And Rob Morrow's kind of like reached the end of his rope. He's like, look, man, like, the guy's not cheating. Like, he's a Columbia professor. He's super smart. Like, you got to give this up. You got to give this up. And like, John Turturro's like so adamant. He's like, he's cheating. He's cheating. He's cheating. And he's like, and Rob Morrow's like, how do you know he got the answers? And he's like, because I got the answers. And it's like, this turn, you're really like, what? Like, you've left out this very important point, and suddenly, like, Rob Morrow is like, whoa, like, this changes everything. I don't mean it's a big turn in the movie, but in the scene, it turns the scene where suddenly, like, John Turturro is not this crazy person, now, like, has a case, and now this case and what Rob Morrow's character thought about it has changed, and each of them have changed each other, because John Turturro has kind of been forced to admit something he felt shameful about.
Right.
And so he leaves the scene feeling kind of shameful that he doesn't admit that, but at the same time, it obviously is going to help, like, him get what he wants, which is to kind of bring down this quiz show
right.
that wronged him.
Right. So the one end of the character is giving up something they don't want to give up. In this right. case, that secrecy, that shame, and right. at the same time, advancing his goal. But that's, from the other character's perspective, there's something totally different going on there.
Right, exactly. So, go ahead.
So I was going to say, that's that intersection. That's a perfect example.
Yeah, and also there, you know, that is the climax of the scene, but there is more that, you know, there's more that happens a little bit after, which is the reaction, the fallout mm-hmm. of this new information. You know, essentially, like I say, it's like, it's when someone drops, like, hot goss, and you're like, what? Like, you can't end the scene there. You kind of have to, like, if that's the height of it, but you kind of have to continue on to, like dissect it. Right. And then you have to figure out how to get out of the scene. Right. So.
Okay. Look, I know we have to wrap up here soon, but I guess the one thing I'd like to wrap up with, if you could, if you would go back in time and talk to young Raamla, what piece of advice would you have for her now, coming back through all this experience you have now?
Oh, that's a great question. I probably would say it's okay that you're watching so much television. Like, it will pay off. It will help you when you can, like, quote, Saved by the Bell, you know, the Jesse Spano episode. Like, someone will find that endearing one day. So, like, it's okay that you're kind of weird and don't quite feel understood completely, because there'd be a place that, like, where your talent that seems weird, and your understanding of pop culture and like nerdist things will all come together and give you success and allow you to pay off your student loans. So
a truly important goal there.
The truly important goal that I haven't reached, but I'm closer than ever. So it's very exciting.
But that, my last follow-up question to your question, when you were watching that stuff as a kid, do you feel like you were you watching and enjoying? Was there something going into your brain? Were you learning? Were you analyzing? Were you finding structure there?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely was. I was learning. I really paid attention to people's names. Like, I could recognize, like, the producers, and I could recognize when something changed. And I didn't understand, but I'd be like, oh, I feel like this person, it said producer last season. Now it says supervising producer. Like, what are they supervising now? Like, I didn't really understand, but I was very aware of, like, people's names, to the point where like some people I hear a name and I'm like, I've seen your name before, and it's like, oh wait, you used to write for Friends, or oh wait, you right. You wrote on 90210. So again, like I really could remember what happened, and that served me well when I was working on Scandal, because you know I was a true fan of the show, so I could be like, oh, we did that in episode 215, or you know, that kind of weird memory that I had of things growing up, which I think my mom kind of took of like, oh my God, please stop watching so much television and like read a book. That helped me later.
Wow. That's great. Well, you heard it from Raamla Mohamed. Watch more TV. That's what we took away, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Raamla Mohamed, thank you so much for doing this with us.
Oh, sure. Thank you so much. It was so much fun. And yeah, I just tell writers to keep writing. I know it's hard, but that if you love it, you should do it.
Yeah. There's nothing else to do if you can't do that.
I am literally qualified to do nothing else.
That's great. Well, Raamla, thank you again. Thank you out there for listening to the podcast and leaving us all the ratings and reviews you guys have been. We really appreciate that. Until next time, I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Right on.